years beyond imagination. I couldn't even eat in the morning. There was a big snowstorm coming to Philly, so it makes us a little bit late, and we get there shaken up.
This is your schedule for today, sweetheart, okay? So the ultrasound is scheduled for 7, so I'm gonna get ready to wrap you right now.
We tried very hard for children the first time. We actually had 2 miscarriages in the beginning before we had Allie. To have Allie was a blessing. So of course, every family wants a boy and a girl and a dog, you know, and a picket fence. You know, it's the American dream. So to find out that I had the American dream and it could be just taken away so quickly, so brutally.
You meet the genetic counselor about 11:30. You have your OB counselor, the OB specialist, around 12 o'clock, okay? Mm-hmm. And then you're going to have another procedure just here around 1:30. Okay? So this is for you, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Mm-mm-mm. The things you do for babies.
Geneva Yoris is a patient who's coming today because of her physician's worry that she may be developing a fetal lower urinary tract obstruction, or LUTO. That means that the urine can no longer get out.
So we went for our first trimester screen. And that screen is where they check for any irregularities with the heart and with any of the organs. At that scan, we found the enlarged bladder. It was over double the size it was supposed to be. The kidneys were very enlarged, very bright, and the doctor was very alarmed. The diagnosis was fatal if there was no intervention.
They look much bigger.
They do look bigger. They're larger than they were.
Over time, the kidneys will be destroyed, and so the amniotic fluid, which is basically made by the kidneys, it disappears, and the baby basically is just compressed. There's no fluid, and so it's just like one huge bear hug for the rest of the pregnancy. The arms and legs can't move, and so they don't develop normally, and the face is compressed against the wall of the uterus, and so the face develops kind of flattening deformities. The baby's constantly under pressure or being bear hugged. The lungs never develop.
The radiologist comes in and takes a look as well. You're looking at the kidneys, hoping that she would say, oh, the kidneys look fine, or something like that, you know.
Now, we're going to turn you to
And she wants to do more scans. And I'm thinking, is this normal? We have been in here for 2 hours.
Well, what would we do if we had an elderly gentleman who had a bladder obstruction? We would put a catheter in it and allow that bladder to drain. And so the pediatric surgeons thought, well, if we can do that after birth, why can't we do that before birth? So they developed a shunt, and the idea is to take a needle and insert it under ultrasound guidance through the mom's abdomen, through the wall of the uterus, making sure that where the tip of that needle comes out is the location that we want to put the shunt in. So how big are these babies when they have shunt procedures? Well, the bodies may be somewhere about this long. The heads may be perhaps the size of a half dollar. You know, it makes for a small target and a small patient.
We had to decide whether we wanted to do medical intervention or possibly terminate the pregnancy. It would just be cruel and unusual to put a newborn child on dialysis, breathing machines.
We thought about the quality of life, and if we saw maybe if both kidneys had failed or something like that, then maybe that would be the signal or the sign to say, okay, maybe we should let this one go. But, well, you know, my wife was telling me, like, she could feel him. You know, he was still moving in there. He was still, still our child, and We didn't really want to end the life.
What's unique about this case is...
So when Dr. Coleman and I sat down to review the ultrasound images, what we saw was certainly not what we expected.
support fund.
We will do whatever we have to do for you, little man. Whatever mommy and daddy have to do.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, Mark Johnson. So I'm one of the high-risk OB and genetic docs, and I've looked at the ultrasound in detail. I think, you know, we're all in agreement that it looks like there's some type of bladder outlet obstruction. When there's an obstruction in the urethra, the urine can't get out.
While he's making these drawings and drawing the bladder and explaining everything, all we're thinking about is, tell me it's okay, tell me it's okay, tell me it's okay. Is it a problem?
And what it's felt to be is a smooth muscle deficiency of the ureters.
And finally, Dr. Johnson moves on to a portion that we have not heard.
So what we're seeing in your case is a little bit different. And what we're seeing now is that the amniotic fluid's gone back to being normal. Okay? So how is that possible?
He threw a route card in there to explain what the current scenario is.
We know that early in bladder development, there is a structure that comes off the top of the bladder that's called the uragus. Sometimes it can open back up. This little uragus has allowed the urine to get out into the amniotic cavity. Okay? As long as that uragus stays open, the bladder should hopefully drain and hopefully prevent additional damage to the kidneys. At this point in time, you have normal amniotic fluid, but if this urethra closes, which it may well do, then we would be in a position to say, do you want us to consider fetal therapy by placing a shunt?
That's...
Yeah.
Wow. So we just hope that that stays open.
Looks promising from us.
Well, I think we're in a wait-and-see mode now.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. No. I think you're probably happiest that you didn't have to get pricked today.
I am. Yes. No large needles today.
I am.
That's good.
Praising and thanking God for this natural solution.
Oh my gosh.
Now we're like, yes. Let's get back to planning. We've got a child coming. Let's get ready.
Not in North Carolina anymore, that's for certain. Oh my God.
Here we go, right here.
At the end of the consultation, Geneva and Reggie were very relieved with the findings, but quite frankly, the story is not at an end. We're in chapter two, and we don't know what the rest of the book is going to turn out to be. You know, when I see these patients, I like to think of them as a mystery, and we don't know where the plot's going to go.
Did you sleep pretty good last night, or?
Yeah. I've been melatonin it up just to get a good sleep every night, not knowing when D-Day would come.
Yeah.
And I'm glad, because D-Day's here, and I feel rested.
Good.
Boom.
How you doing, Shelly?
Good.
As soon as Daddy-O gets here, we'll have a birthday party.
Now that we're ready, thanks for getting everything set up here, folks.
Okay.
Decision cut.
I'm fine. Totally numb.
You are numb-alicious.
Yeah, please keep breathing.
It's very thick though there.
Well, let's see that
it
membrane
down,
separation.
I don't know where.
We good?
Slow. Mm-hmm. Hello, look at your sweet little face. We've been a long time waiting to see you.
Hi. There she is, baby.
Her back looks great. Hi, beautiful.
Hey, baby.
You are a cutie.
No, okay? So this is Luwell.
Luwell, I love it.
When babies who have undergone fetal vomiting and cell repair are born, there's no immediate gratification saying this kid's going to walk, this kid's not going to walk. We have to wait for motor function until the babies are ready to walk or beyond.
You know that voice?
It's also important to impress on the mother, the parents, that fetal vomiting and seal repair is not a cure. We hope to prevent the need for a shunt tube. We hope to reverse the hindbrain herniation, which, if it's not reversed, can cause cranial nerve problems, and the baby can have problems with breathing, swallowing, that can be life-threatening. The hope is to help dramatically, but the operation is not a cure.
Well,
she
just
kind of like trying to clean her up before mommy comes. Oh, honey, it's okay. It's okay.
Just continue our protocol as we have it, and we'll go from there.
Okay, great. Thank you.
What we're seeing in Shelley's baby is full range of motion, flexion and extension at the hips, at the knees, at the ankles. You see the little toes wiggling. So all that looks very good. It's the exact same thing you would see in a normal newborn. You can be cautiously optimistic. Cautiously optimistic. Time will tell.
Aww. She's starting to wake up. Hey, baby girl.
My perspective of her coming home was, I thought it was going to be really, 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 really hard. I never thought it was going to be easy, ever. But now that we're home, it's like, yeah, I can do this.